Good day, fellow investors. Today I want to share with you three investment strategies that are off the beaten path and three stock picks that if you mention them in the investment environment, current investment environment, you are most likely to get fired than to get a big bonus at the end of the year. However, I think that when applying common sense, sometimes, especially in the late part of the economic cycle, it is smart to go a little bit counter the current, so be a contrarian investment. Being a contrarian investor over the long term provides better diversification and over the long term higher returns with lower risk, which is the essence of value investing. So let's start with the free investment thesis and stock picks. The topics for today: my copper thesis, my gold thesis, my China thesis, and then the free stocks to watch, buy, whatever you want, because I'll give you a risk and reward discussion and tell you which ones are on my watch list and which one I'm long. So let's start with copper. The world is getting electrical. Renewables, everybody's talking about less CO2, less global warming, whatever. And when I think about all that, electrical vehicles, Tesla, loop, tunnels, trains, whatever, and everything goes electrical, solar panels. And then I think, okay, what is one thing that all those projects, no matter who wins, who what, have in common? It is copper, because you need copper to bring that electricity from point A to point B. So my theory is that copper might be really the metal of the next decade. When you look at copper, when you look at the potential supply and the potential demand, there is a supply gap opening somewhere around 2020-2022, which means that copper prices should be significantly higher over the next decade than they have been recently. This will lead to higher prices, higher revenues for copper miners, and thus they might be a great investment. If you look at the world map, where is the biggest economic growth? You see here Asia is extremely green, growth rates of above 5%. Those countries are not that developed yet, but as you grow in development, as you build in infrastructure, as more people move into cities, you need more and more copper. Thus, that is again a plus for copper. You can see here how India and China still have very low levels of urbanization when compared to the developed world. As they get closer to the developed world, this might really be a good decade or two decades for copper, especially as the supply is lower and the copper in the ground is more difficult to mine. The second thesis is another metal, but a completely different metal. It's gold. Now, gold, we know, has no actual value, except for the fact that it is relatively fixed in the amount and it costs to mine out. So when I see gold, I see it as a hedge, as a protection against monetary policies, against the Fed printing money or whatever has been going on. So therefore, I think that gold should be a part of every portfolio in today's world. If we look at the European Central Bank balance sheet, this is what happened in the last 15 years. So it went from around 700 billion euros to more than 4.5 billion euros, thus an increase of about 7 times. That is crazy. Similarly, the US debt level over the past 50 years has exploded from 30% of GDP to the current above 100% of GDP. Now, how do you pay off debt? How do you stimulate the economy? By debasing the currency. Every government in the past history of 8,000 years since we have currency has debased their currency. Debasing means lowering the actual value of the currency, because then you have inflation and the debt repayment is much easier, the debt restructuring. I suppose that in the next recession, the easiest way out for Europe, for Japan, for the US will be to print more money, debase the currency, and thus have more money in the economy, fixed amount of gold. Gold should do well in that case. So it is a hedge that you should be exposed to. My third thesis is China. China currently in turmoil, but whatever you are hearing around, they are working on their long-term plans. One road, one belt initiative, they are building it, they are investing, and they are connecting their world, no matter what you think, no matter whether you like it or not, and they are becoming the biggest economy in the world very, very soon. So in that light, These are the theses. Now let's see about the stocks. One stock that I already discussed in a full video here, and you'll see whether you are interested in that or not, is Lundin Mining. I have made a full analysis on my stock market research platform about Lundin Mining, and I'll summarize the findings, and you can watch more in the video or check my platform if you want to dig deeper into that specific stock. So Lundin Mining, it is a miner that has a few mines across the world, mostly mining copper, and then I take the flagship mine, Candelaria mine, and I put copper prices in a model, what happens at what copper price, what is the present value at a 15% discount rate, and I get that at a copper price of 3.5, the present value of the after-tax cash flows expected from the mine for Candelaria, for Lundin's flagship mine, are 1.648 billion. Plus they have 1.5 billion in cash on the balance sheet, plus there are other mines, always using a 15% discount rate, the Neves mine, 610 million, a little bit lower now, I have adjusted it, 500 million, Zinkgruvan, 230 million, Eagle, 543 million. Sum of value, Candelaria, Neves, Zinkgruvan, Eagle. There is 1.5 billion of cash on Lundin's balance sheet. So that's $2 per share, compare it to the price of four. That is some margin of safety. The debt is 436 million, total value 4 billion from my calculations at a 15% discount rate. The current market capitalization is 3 billion, my value is 4 billion, so we are closer to an expected long-term return from Lundin when copper prices hit 3.5 of about 20%. However, if we look at Lundin's stock price, it's now at 4, it was at 8 just a few months ago, and 2 years ago it was at 2. So when you are investing in copper miners, you have to accept the volatility. Lundin is now at 4 something lower, up a little bit lower, but it can go to 3 very easily, it can go to 2 easily, it can even go to 1.5, because that's how the market perceives those miners. If copper prices go below 2, like there is a possibility, if there is a recession coming in the next year or two, then you will see Lundin at 2 and below 1.5. So keep in mind the risks when you are approaching such an investment. So risk 2, 1.5, even 1 if things get really bad. And the upside is if copper hits 3.5 somewhere in the next 5 years, which is possible, then I see an upside of, I don't know, 8, 12. However, you have to take account of the volatility, which is not something that the standard investment environment, institutional investors, like to give to their clients. That's why Lundin is a contrarian play. Disclaimer, I am long Lundin. I recently opened the position in Lundin. I have a full strategy on how to approach investing in Lundin, when to buy more, when to sell what I have bought, and how to take advantage of that volatility. It takes a lot of time to explain that, but you will see yourself as you dig into the company if you like it, how to approach, what can happen or not. Thesis 2. As I already showed you, the debt of the US government is crazy, and JP Morgan recently said that the probability of a recession in 4 years is 100%. So what will the Fed do? What will politicians do when the next recession comes, which day by day is getting closer? So they will probably do what they did in the past 10 years, print more money, lower interest rates. What happens with gold prices when that happens? Gold prices should go up. And one way of getting exposure to that is owning a miner. One of the most stable miners out there in the world, diversified across good jurisdictions, is Newmont Mining, and it also owns the Carlin mine in Nevada. And with that name, you cannot go wrong. Global portfolio of long life assets, and just a quick update, I have also made a video about Newmont, so you can check for more details. The current price when I did the analysis was 30. The upside if gold hits 2000, according to my present value calculations, is 106. The downside if gold hits 800 is 5. So another high, let's say risky leveraged play, but you have to see how this fits your portfolio or not. There is also a dividend of 1.7. Don't count off the dividend if gold prices fall below 1,100, etc. Number three, I said China. So China, there are lots of crazy stocks, but there are also really stable stocks that are really great businesses. One great business is, wherever you are, it's an airport. What happens with China's GDP growth at 6.5 as we see it? More people, more spending, more flying. And this is Beijing Airport. What will it look like in 10, 20 years with the One Road, One Belt, with China being the leading economy in the world? Will it be there? Will be more people, more spending? Probably yes. Price earnings ratio of 11 at the moment will be a little bit higher because there was some regulatory influence that took off 10% of a fee in revenue, so that's something to take into account. The dividend is 3.6%. And when you compare the PE ratio of 10 with all other airports in the world, it is really a crazy bargain. However, I wouldn't invest on valuation. I have made the model here, and my present value for a 15% expected return from Beijing Capital Airport is $1.2, but then I put in the risks for China, risks from devaluation of the currency, risks from a slowdown in China, and then my entry point is around 0.8, 0.9. I will still see that whether the company will ever get to that. But if you want a good business with, again, keeping in mind the regulatory risk in China, then this is an idea for the long term. So these are the stocks, such stocks I usually follow. You understand the principle. The risk is, okay, I know what the risk is. This can go so much down and all can go down very much. However, in the next 10, 20 years, the potential for the upside is really, really very big. And then London has 1.5 billion in cash. So if those stock prices go lower, my upside in the future gets higher, and I'm happy to average down if necessary. I'm not so sure about Newmont. I'm still will be looking into all gold miners and finding perhaps better risk reward situations, better or lower costs, etc. So that's just an idea, food for thought for Newmont. However, in that long term, putting such puzzle pieces into the portfolio, I hope to get to a nice, decent return no matter what happens in the world, no matter what the Fed does, no matter what Trump does. So I hope I have given you some ideas, some food for thought for your portfolio. And to give a disclaimer, never ever invest on YouTube videos, never ever invest on anybody's other opinion, not even mine, not even what I do. Please do your own due diligence and then see how that fits your portfolio. Focus on the risks as a value investor does. Risk first, then compare it to the upside. And then see what would you do if the risks materialize and what would you do if the positivity materialize. So really think about, okay, where am I wrong? Where is Sven wrong? What can go wrong? What would I do if it goes wrong? And then, only then, invest and make a portfolio. Thank you for watching. Check my stock market research platform, link in the description below, for more ideas for more similar stocks and see whether this kind of investing fits your portfolio. See you in the next video.